Jesus has just gathered his disciples on the hillside to teach, but folks kept coming and coming and coming because they had heard about this one who was bringing good news, who was bringing, saying things that had not been said before. So we find ourselves this morning in chapter 5 at the very outset. The first thing in the Sermon on the Mount are the Beatitudes. But then Jesus really begins to preach. And hear the words of our Lord as he speaks to the 12 and the multitudes on top of them. Verse 13, he says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing, but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. You are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all who are in the house. So let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven." And he goes on, "Do not think that I came to destroy the law or the prophets. I did not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For assuredly I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law until all is fulfilled. Whoever therefore breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches men so shall be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does and teaches them, he shall be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I say to you that unless your righteousness exceeds the righteousness of the scribes and Pharisees, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. From the time I was about this big, I started hearing things about the pillars of the church. Now, I wasn't really old enough to know what the pillar of the church was, but I figured it out. You know, I went through long enough and I learned what the pillar of the church was. And we could get every one of us in this church today, and we could try and try and try to knock that sucker down. Please don't fall. And it just would not happen. Because the pillars of the church, these huge cylinders, hold things up. But then, as I got older, I heard transference. And that term, pillar, transferred to who or to what? It transferred to people. And who were the folks that held the church up, so to speak? And if you think about your life, you have been exposed to so many people that you would call pillars of the church. They were examples. They were mentors. They were people that held up the Christian faith so you could look at it and say, "I want some of that." Those are the ones that we think of as the pillars of the church. But that was yesterday. What about today? Who are the pillars of the church? And somebody just might be looking at you or at me as a pillar of the church. And that begs the question, what kind of a pillar are we? Well, Jesus answers that question for us in the text this morning, but we've got to have a little bit of historical context to go with it. We've got to put his words and his images into the time and the culture of that day. Anyone who can remember back to their 9th, 10th, 11th grade history classes on Greek and Roman culture has to remember, or maybe you remember, or you might remember, that there were three distinct different kinds of columns used in Greek and Roman culture. And these columns were used to support and hold up those huge stately monuments and temples and public buildings that graced that world in that day. I'm going to give you a test. Let's see if anybody remembers your columns. Anybody? Randy?
I'm Lord Randy.
Time for the benediction. Okay. Good job. Doric and benediction, and Corinthian, you're right. The three main types. And these supporting pillars frame the entrances of the most imposing, majestic architectural wonders that the world has ever known. Yet, if you've ever been to Athens, or if you've ever been to Rome, or you've ever been to anywhere in that part of the world, time and decay, war and earthquakes and nature has left us very little of those magnificent buildings, except a few of those stately pillars. The Parthenon, the Colosseum, their grandeur is just barely visible. If you look at those remaining columns that still stand upright and intact, and if you look at them and you let your mind go way back into history, it looks kind of like the bones of an ancient, extinct dinosaur. If you've ever been over there, I think you know what I mean. The pillars, to some degree, remain. But the fact is, the people that put them up, the powers that paid for them long time ago, well, those people with powers long time ago crumbled into the dust and are gone. We find them now in our history books. And pillars had a dual purpose sometimes. In the ancient world, pillars holding up the front of something could either be a sign of welcome, holding it up, saying, come on in, or it could be a sign of a warning, why don't you stay out there where you want to be? Anybody know what the pillars of Hercules are? They're where the Mediterranean Sea goes into the Atlantic Ocean. You've got Gibraltar in the north, you've got Morocco in the south, and you've got this body of water between, coming from the Atlantic to the Mediterranean. And it's mountains, the Rock of Gibraltar on one side, and the mountains there in Morocco on the other side. They have shared two different titles, you know, because at some point in time, they said to people leaving the Mediterranean, stop. Don't go out into that uncharted body of water. Nobody knows what's there. And that was supposed to be where the end of the world began, was right there at the Pillars of Hercules. But by the time of the Holy Roman Empire and the time of Charles V, and this is somewhere around 1530, 1540, I don't think, a couple of you might remember it, but you know, somewhere it was long, long time ago. You know, the Pillars of Hercules sent a different message, because at that point in time, the Spanish and the Portuguese explorers were beginning to go out across the Atlantic, and those pillars had to be rechristened. And what the rechristening name in Latin meant is that there is a further beyond. So, to make it simple, the pillars had gone from being a protective gate that closed in the existing Mediterranean world and all that was familiar to them, and it became a gate, an opening gate, that opened into the new world of possibilities. And those pillars are kind of like what Jesus summons us to be. In biblical texts, think about where we run into pillars in the Bible. Pillars have a mixed message, just like they did then. When Abraham and his family fled Sodom and Gomorrah, did they all make it out alive? No, they didn't. Who didn't make it out alive?
Lot's
wife, because she didn't follow instructions. She didn't listen, and she looked back. And so, when she did, she became a pillar. She got zapped. And God turned her into a pillar of salt. Definitely not a good pillar. So Lot's wife becomes a pillar of salt and does not move forward because she wanted to cling to her past. She wanted to cling to her tradition. And biblical tradition, although it doesn't say so many words in the Bible, that it was her tears. She was so sad that she cried so much that the saltiness of her tears rose from her feet all the way up and froze her. And she became that pillar of salt. And as a pillar, she was unable to move forward into the future, into the potential, into the possibility that God was offering to them. But there were more positive pillars that we know about. When the Hebrew slaves fled Egypt, they were guided through the wilderness by two distinctively holy divine pillars. A pillar of
fire
and a pillar of smoke. You know, clouds. But it was a pillar of smoke. It was pillars. It was God. It was God's pillars that were moving. They weren't stationary. They were animated. They were dynamic. God had the pillars moving, and what did they do? They led the people. What do we think about in today's mindset? If we call someone a pillar of the church, that's somebody who's showing God's will, who's doing what God wants them to do, who is on the move, who is not living in the past, who is going forward wherever God leads to reach the promised land, to get there. The Israelites, they had to keep up with God, the God of smoke, the God of fire, that God who stood by them and never abandoned them, but he was also a God who never, ever quit leading them forward. So when Jesus stands up in front of those folks there on the mountain and preaches what we have come to call the Sermon on the Mount, his audience was probably almost entirely Jewish. And his opening statements in the sermon, the Beatitudes, extolled and praised behaviors and attitudes that were so recognized in the Jewish wisdom literature. They knew what he was saying, but there was a difference in what he said and what the wisdom writers had said. Because Jesus didn't promise that these actions, Jesus didn't promise that these attitudes would serve those who practiced them well in the world. In Jewish wisdom teaching, doing good generally resulted in getting a tangible reward. That's just the way it was. Good deeds equal good rewards. Well, if you think about the Beatitudes that Jesus talked about, they did not promise this ethical, for lack of a better way to put it, ethical equation. In fact, if you go back and you study the Beatitudes, Beatitudes warned that this world always would not recognize the rightness, the correctness of righteousness. Jesus, though, was looking beyond that. this world. Jesus was looking forward. Jesus was looking to the kingdom of God, to a time of divine fulfillment when the